Some things have been updated, some things need updated. In the next bulletin, some of these things will go away unless there's some updates. And I'm encouraging you to reach out to these people whose name you know or don't know. Let them know that you've been praying for them. You know, many times we take these things for granted, which brings me probably close to today's message. Many times we find ourselves taking one another for granted. We have expectations of one another, perhaps right, wrong, or indifferent. But you know, the idea here is that we need to see whether or not we're in the center of God's will for your life. Are we really? Let me ask this morning. Are you where you want to be with Jesus? Are you as close as you could be with him? Has he made a difference in your life that perhaps maybe he wants to do more in your life? And I just want to encourage you this morning, because I think we need to be reminded of a few things, and I'm going to bring up some things. As you look around in any church today, I had the privilege of stopping and visiting recently at one of our larger churches, and it's a beautiful place, and talking about what goes on there, and you know, they've got a couple hundred people, and you'll say, wow, that would be not well, a couple hundred people fill this place right up, wouldn't it? But they have a sanctuary that can hold 1,500. Now, here's the thing, historically, they have had over 1,000. They were doing 3 services on a Sunday. And as we spoke about this, the pastor who's there, he's been there for many years. He wasn't there back when he was there. He was a member of that church, you could say, in the heyday. But what has happened? What has happened? Have we bought into the world's ideology? Have we bought into that gospel light that says, you know, if it had just been you, Jesus would have died just for you. And but we stopped there and said, oh, I'm sure glad he died for me. Sorry for the rest of you. And the idea is, and then my thought here on this, or what my take on it is, listen, if you really have received Jesus, that person that's sitting next to you right now, or anyone that comes in your midst, you are required by him to share him. Did you hear that? You know, think about what Jesus. Jesus came first for the Jew and also for the Gentiles. First for the Jew. Some of us, we want to make ourselves feel, oh, we're the first and the last that he came for. No, wait. He came that we might have life and have it more abundantly.
Amen.
And I understand what that means. It's not just to get me to heaven. And if you came to him only to go to heaven, I think you may be a little bit surprised if that's what your thought is. Because that's not the reason he came, just to bring you to heaven. Just to be clear, did you know our heavenly destination is kind of a fringe benefit? Did you hear what I'm saying? Our heavenly destination is a fringe benefit. Oh, don't get me wrong. This morning, if you have a job and have fringe benefits, how many of you are working that job? You may not even care for it as much as you could, but because of the benefits, you stay. And there are going to be times in your walk with the Lord, it's not going to seem pleasant to you. And you're going to have to make, sometimes you have to make sacrifices. But right now, if you look around and you think about who you would love to see sitting with you, worshiping the Lord. Are you hearing this? Hearing the word of God. Being fitly joined together. Amen? And we understand that people are going to say and do things maybe that don't really agree with us quite so much and don't set with us. Does it really matter as much as does it set well with God? And does your attitude, does it reflect an attitude that sets well with God? I mean, I'm asking all these questions because there are some folks out there, they're seeking answers. They're looking for the answers we all, and listen, almost every one of us, probably all of us want to know, well, I mean, the great answer, where do we go after we leave this world? But it's not just that. If all you're concerned about the afterlife and you forget the here life, the life here, the Bible says, it talks about now faith. Now faith. Say that with me. Now faith.
Now faith.
That's a time frame. Now faith. What is faith? Well, faith is
substance
of things hoped for, things of not yet seen. Now faith brings you to a place where you really understand what it means to be a child of God, to be a friend of God, to be a brother of Jesus, amen? Would you all stand this morning for the reading of the word? Together,
pour out your spirit, Lord,
that we might dream
for
your faith. Hear my plea of innocence, O Lord. Give heed to my cry.
Listen to my prayer, which shall not come from my enemies.
Let my vindication come forth from your presence. Summon me by night.
Melt me down into a wild purity in me.
Keep me as the apple of your eye.
Hide me under the shadow of your wings.
From the wicked who assault me.
From my deadly enemies who surround me.
Pour
out your spirit, Lord, that we might dream your dream.
Say that again.
Pour out your spirit, Lord, that we might dream your dream.
You dance so very.
pray these prayers with me, just a few brief prayers, because I believe that everyone, I don't even need someone praying for you because you want God to come save. How many of you right now would say, Lord, there are people in my life I've been praying for, I wish they would listen to you on behalf of my prayers? Maybe you too can agree with many of the trials that we end up having in our life, and the things that cause us to have our relationships shaken. And things don't always happen the way you want them. And sometimes we'll do things that we want, maybe God didn't really want. But just to be clear, did you know we don't live? It'd be nice if we could live within God's perfect will. But aren't you glad for his permissive will?
Amen.
What does it mean by that, having a permissive will? Well, see, he might permit you to do some things, but the Apostle Paul said that all things were permissible, were allowed for him, but not everything was good for him. And we could continue on and we could understand, because what the devil meant for evil, God can turn for good. Now, that doesn't mean that he takes evil and makes it good. That's what many of us try to do. That's not what we're talking about. I've got one more statement to make before we pray. You may be going through some things. You may be experiencing some things in your life. You may have been asking God that he needs to fix your circumstances, your situation. There's some fixing that needs to go on in your life. And up to this point, he has not done it. Has he failed? No, just to be clear, God never fails.
Amen.
He never fails.
God never fails.
Just saying, my testimony, he's never failed me. But here's what I'm telling you. There may be some things in your life that you're looking for God to intervene and to correct. But there may be some things that need some fixing in your life. But the reason he hasn't fixed those things in your life is because he's using those things, those events, those particular items in your life that are giving you pain and heartache. He's using them to fix you.
Amen.
Did you hear that? Walking through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. I know that the Bible says in this world we're going to have a rough time. But I believe that God will deliver us from those in due time. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So what I would like for you to do this morning is to join me in prayer for both Keith and Myrtle and all those that you know. Oh, and don't leave yourself out of this mix. Never exclude yourself from prayer. Don't act like you don't need prayer. We need to learn to pray for ourselves and others. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Father God, we pray this morning that God, that you would give this couple strength to release any divisiveness that builds emotional walls between themselves and also others. And we're asking Messiah, Jesus, and Lord to strengthen this couple to listen before speaking, and Lord, to be able to release their own expectations of what others should do or say, and Lord, to be open to hear what you would say.
Thank you,
dear Jesus, through the power of your Holy Spirit, someone say, Holy Ghost.
Holy Ghost.
Hear our prayers.
Hear our prayers.
For these newlyweds. And we pray, that you strengthen them, to release any anger, divisiveness, and help them to see that anger and resentment doesn't bring the results that anyone wants. Leave vengeance to God, because God says they're his. And Almighty God, hear our prayers. Stay with me. Hear our prayers. And teach this couple, these newlyweds, and remind us how to understand the needs of each other. In Jesus' name. Would you give the Lord again a hand clap of praise? And would you give the newlyweds a hand clap as well?
Yeah.
Welcome to the Lord's house.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Jesus. Praise.
We're going to take a seat and ask that the usher would prepare to come forward this morning and receive your offering. Do you know that when you came into the house of God this morning, you brought your best offering? Did you hear that? You brought in your best offering.
Yes.
Now, obviously, we collect what we call the first fruits. We call them tithes. We'll be preaching about that in the next couple of weeks. To understand what that means, I'll just give you one little footnote about that. Tithing is not gifting. You're not giving God a gift. You're just giving him what he's due.
Yes.
Amen.
Your offering of yourself that you brought in today is the greatest gift you could offer. And oftentimes it's tied to the wallet or the purse strings. But there are other gifts that we bring to him. It has been said that tithing is a low watermark for the Christian because it's the least, listen to this, it's the least we should do.
Amen.
And many of us, we live our lives based upon, I'm only doing the least I can do to get by. I have days of my job where I'm of an attitude, I just want to make it through to retirement. But you know what I realize, and most of anybody who knows me, said, you know, you're never going to retire until I'm retired from this world. And when I leave this world, I believe, this is my belief, I don't believe we're just going to sit around in padded pews in heaven. Somebody say, amen.
Amen.
I know we're going to spend a lot of time around the throne singing praises.
Yeah.
This is just a rehearsal. And for some of us, it's a little bit more work and effort than it is for others, but mostly because we are hanging on so much to these dead vessels. You say, well, because I crucified my flesh, it's dead, but I'm hanging on to it just in case.
No.
It's kind of, I'll put it to you like this. Maybe you know some people like this, maybe it describes some of us here today. Do you remember, and maybe you don't have to think too hard, there's this pair of shoes. They're worn out. I mean, you know, there are holes in them, but man, they were your favorite pair of shoes and they're so comfortable. You just can't throw them out. And maybe it might not be that. Maybe it's just there's some things in your life that have just such great sentimental value, you can't release it. And unfortunately, what you find out is that many times we're valuing dead things over what Jesus wants us to have. Life and that more abundantly. And what happens as we grow as a family, and we have, by the way, I'll give honorable mention to the Smiths family, you know, but there should have been two babies. I just want you to know, there should have been two. 10 pounds, 14 ounces, that's two babies, okay? But anyway, beautiful little boy, oh my gosh. And when we went to visit, and the first sounds I hear, what is that, a raccoon? The little sounds it makes. He just such a special little boy, anyway, and special parents. And did you know he's got a special family right here, right now?
Amen.
My point is, don't just try to get by with the least you can do. From my responsive reading, how many of you want to be able to dream his dreams?
Amen.
We're talking about glory, and then how many of you want to make his dreams come true? Would you lift your hand to heaven right now? That might be the start. Father, I release my ideas to you, even as I release the offering. Lord, may it be pleasing to you. And Lord, help us to be more extravagant in our giving, not just here, but to all those that we know. Lord, let us share Jesus. Let us share the life that he's given to us. We ask God for a special blessing, that Lord, that you would multiply the impact with the Holy Spirit of power, in Jesus' name, and the church agreed, all said,
amen.
Amen. Go ahead, gentlemen. While they're coming around, I'd like you to open up your Bibles to a very familiar scripture most of us are acquainted with, at least. And I'm sure if, as we read it, you're going to say, oh, yeah, I've heard this before. If you've been in church, and certainly Sunday school, and been reading the Bible on your own. Mark, in the first chapter, the Gospel of Mark, Matthew, Mark is the second gospel. We just want to share this morning the idea of what our ministry is supposed to be. Amen? Mark chapter 1. Let me know when you get there.
Amen.
I got an amen. Today I'm going to be speaking on the idea of witness. It's our ministry. Now sometimes we take this word ministry to mean something that's reserved for a special group of people. Pastors, Sunday school teachers, worship leaders, and the like. But in fact, every one of us have been called to be ministers. Ministry is nothing more than a minister is nothing more than someone who provides a service. The idea, of course, when we start talking about Christian ministry is that which motivates us. We're not just motivated because, well, that's just what we do. No, it might be just, but no, there's more to it than that. Or sometimes our ministry, it's the least we can do. But then there are those, and I hope many of us who hear this message will realize that we really need to come to a place in our life where we're not doing the least that we can do, but we come to realize that there's more that we could do and should do, and we need to encourage our brothers and sisters alike. Think about this. The Bible says that you shall love the Lord. How? Now, if you think about that, you might say that's the least that you can do. But when you think about what that means, with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, there's nothing more that you can do if you're doing it. If you're, what's this, totally surrendered. The song we just sang, you are my king, when I'm not sitting on the throne. You are my king. When someone else is not telling me what to do. You are, wait a second. Is he truly the king of your life? And maybe we're not really sure what that means because, you know, and just to be clear, you know, the United States of America is not a democracy, it's a republic. Right? Okay? It's a government by the people, for the people. A democracy says everybody's equal. And did you know that there is some truth to everybody being equal? We are all equal in God's sight. Red and yellow, black and white, we're all precious in his sight. Can we agree on that?
Amen.
Now, I'm going to make a statement now. You may have to go to the altars right away. Because if you agree with that right now, but then there's that time or those circumstances in your life when you've seen someone and you felt or you thought there's no hope for them. Did you know you just condemned yourself?
Right.
And you've just done a disservice to your king. You know, there's things in our life that we understand that God is greater than all these things. That Christ in us is greater than all these things. I'll share a brief story, then I want to get right into this. It's kind of part of the message. Because I was, quite often I get privileged to. It's like I get an inside track to some people I hardly know. And I was sitting with these guys, and it's a father and son kind of a thing going on. And, you know, it's like this, a father and his brother and his son, they all work at the same place, and they're sitting there talking about Jesus. And I'm just sitting there getting me something cool to drink, and I'm going to stay here for a while. Anyway, the conversation was going on, and apparently these two brothers, dad and an uncle, were trying to convince or to impress upon this young man he needed Jesus. And I listened. He's got trouble. How many got trouble in your life?
Amen.
All God's children got trouble too, amen? Just because you come to Jesus doesn't make all your troubles go away. That'll be another coming message. But they start talking about everything that's going on in his life. Now, the brother nor the father mentioned anything about the things that this boy was into. But the boy did. Well, if I come to Jesus, in order for me to come to Jesus, I've got to give up my weed, I've got to give up my beer, and I've got to give up my women. And his dad says, no, you don't. You don't have to give any of that up before you come to Jesus. Now, I'm giving you the short version of the story, because when I heard that said the first time, I said, all right, I'm intrigued. I got to hear this. Are you with me so far? You don't have to do all that to come to Jesus. You don't have to do all that to accept it. You don't have to do these things. You don't have to give up the gambling. You don't have to give up the carousing. You don't have to give up the drinking to come to Jesus. It was about 25 minutes into the conversation, and I finally got an idea of what was going on, and the bell rang, and I got it. And I said, I talked to the man. They know my name, but I don't know theirs, but I've been there before. I said, can I make a comment? And the uncle said, please do, Pastor. What? Apparently he knows me better. I said, do you know what your dad is trying to tell you? Well, yeah, I said, I don't have to give up anything to come to Jesus. I said, yeah, but what you're not really getting here is, why is it you think you have to give these things up before you come to Jesus? Or let me put it to you another way. Why are these things so important to you that you won't exchange them for Jesus? Here's the thing. I will promise you this. If someone comes to Christ, he'll give up the weed, he'll give up the drinking, he'll give up the carousing, he'll give up the gambling, he'll give up all these things. Why? Because Christ is greater than all these things.
Amen.
Did you hear what I said? Christ is greater. And this morning's message is about being a witness and going out there and bringing people to Jesus. And unfortunately, what happens is sometimes we go a little bit too far with what Paul said. He became all things to all people. Unfortunately, we start looking so much like other people, they don't know that there's a difference. Why? Because we're doing the same things they do. We involve ourselves in the same sort of activities that they do. And you're going to ask yourself, is this the sort of thing that God would have me involved in to be a witness? You see, it's not just about, well, yeah, let me give you something else. You can give up all that stuff. You can give it up. You can have the willpower, you can have the willpower to give all that stuff up and still not really ever receive Jesus. Well, why would that be? And some of you might be guilty of this. Because you are strong-willed, you're going to do what you want to do no matter what. And I mean no matter what. And you're going to go ahead and you're going to claim the victory for yourself, in and of yourself. Well, how did you give it? I just decided to give it up. Here's something. How many of you came to Jesus because you just chose to come to Jesus? Anybody, did you ever choose to come to Jesus? Let me say, let me help you out with something. If it was just your choice, if it was just a message, it was just the idea, it was just, a different angle on a new life. All I have to do is believe. I believe on Jesus. I know all about him. Okay, I'm saved, right? Probably I'm at least a good foot to get started, but what does it mean to be saved? I know I'm really kind of pouring it on this morning, but you got to understand something. Did you know that God is greater than all these things? But if you're only serving Jesus because you chose to, I'm going to tell you this. Yeah, I still have a choice. Do you believe that? Do you know that we still have free choice? Free will, right? We still have a choice. But there's something that happened to me. I don't know how many years ago it happened. It kind of caught me off guard. Coming into ministry wasn't something that I was pursuing from a childhood. I had no idea what that was even about. But I got to a point in my life where I must serve Jesus. I've got to. Oh, I could choose not to, but there's something in me that's like fire shut up in my bones. It's like this burning desire that I've got to share him. And I want to be seen in favor of him. Amen?
Amen.
So this morning we're talking about being a witness, being just our ministry. And it's not just about a thing that people do, just Sunday school teachers and preachers and the like, and evangelists and things like that. No, every one of us, the scripture tells us, even as you have received mercy, how many received mercy through Christ?
Amen.
At that moment, it says you now have a ministry. It is pretty simple. Share Jesus. Mark chapter 1. Listen, let me just share just a few verses of this thing. We can read all through the chapter. You can do that another time. But right now, let's just go to start in verse 14. Now, after John, talking about John the Baptist, after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." And as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Peter, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And then Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." They immediately left their nets, and they followed him. Question. Do we believe the scriptures? Do we believe this one? Of course we do. But is it true? Is this true in our lives? Have we become fishers of men since we began to follow him? And if we have not, why not? And listen, Jesus said, "I will make you become fishers of men." Not "I can make you," not "I might make you." He says, "I will make you fishers of men." Now, our tendency today, and well, Brother Mike and others will agree to this because we've watched this now for the last couple of decades and before, the tendency today is churches to become program-oriented rather than people-oriented. The church was meant to be a specific local gathering of people. It's a gathering where the people would come, where their pastor would teach and preach and equip saints for the work of ministry. That's what the church is for the equipping of saints for ministry. Maybe that's one of the reasons many don't come, because if they come, they're going to get equipped and they're going to be expected to go to work. And how many of you understand, for the most part, being human also means being lazy? I really understand that when Paul said, "But by the grace of God, there I go, because I'm lazy. I'd rather stay at home. I'd rather have my Sundays off. I'd rather go fishing rather than being fishers of men." Because I know some fishermen that they're fantastic at catching some fish. They know how to bait the hook, and they know how to cast it in the right hole, and they know how to get them to take the bait. See, the thing is, that's not how we're going to be living our lives. It's not about getting someone to take the bait. We don't need to bait them in. Here's what happens. Did you know that the Holy Spirit causes someone to come to Jesus? And because, you know, Pentecost Sunday was just last Sunday. Many of us right now, we claim the Holy Spirit. We have the baptism of the Spirit, some of us do. And everyone who's saved, by the way, everybody who's saved has the Spirit within them. And wait, hold on. Are you ready for this? Did you know that the Holy Ghost and the Spirit of God's already been poured out on everybody? Well, how do you figure that? Because God said so. He said, "I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh." Let's go back to that idea about thinking that we've got a corner on the gospel or any given particular set of skill sets. Okay? Everything that I do because God gave me the ability to do it. Amen? By the grace of God, there you go. There I go. Amen? So the idea here is each individual believer being gifted of God is to be responsive to the Word of God, and they're to be active in the work of God. You hear the Word of God, you do the work. You hear the Word, you do the work. You hear the Word, you do the work. Amen? But because of unresponsiveness and unproductivity-ness, I don't know, maybe that's a word, unproductivity-ness. If not, write it down and put it in a new Pastor Tony English dictionary. Anyway, but A majority of believers, I mean, the church has chosen in many cases to substitute schemes and programs to compensate for our failure. Just to be clear, programs have their place. Did you hear that? There's a place for that. But how effective have we been with our programs? I have spent countless hours here in this sanctuary, in my office, and other places, going over in my mind all the things that we've done, and I look and I see certain levels of success. Unfortunately, the levels of success have been darkened by the levels of failure and disappointment. Part of the reason is because everybody wants to believe it's somebody else's job, somebody else's responsibility. Well, that's the pastor's job. That's what, you know, take it to the pastor. Well, you know, the toilet doesn't flush. Don't tell the pastor. There's a stain in the carpet. Go tell pastor. Don't you think pastors have a little more to do than be concerned about that? This is the things that the body says, let's just take care of it. Let's fix this thing. We'll tell them what we did afterwards. And some of you might have to ask forgiveness later, but that's okay. You'll get a good grade for effort. But just to sit back and just wait, when you have got the ability, the wherewithal to do something. Then every one of us, did you know every one of us has an ability, the same ability to witness to somebody if you have Jesus? Or should I say, if you have surrendered to him? All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. Amen?
Amen.
I surrender all. I surrender all to him, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. I'm going to give up. I'm going to lay down my pride. I might have to do things that are undignified. Brother William, I might have to clean the toilet from time to time. And that's all right. Somebody needs to do it, amen? But it doesn't necessarily have to be just because I can do it. There's probably others that could be taught how to do it. It goes back to Mother's Day, and I told the story about that young girl who could not cook. Okay, so she was a young woman. She's married. She can't cook. She barely can make toast without burning it. But you find out her mom and her grandmother and all her aunties were fantastic cooks. But what you hear from her is, I was never allowed in the kitchen because mom and my auntie and my grandma all said they could do it better than me. So I never learned to cook. How many of you right now could be a good mechanic without somebody teaching you something?
Yeah.
Or anything else? And about cooking, yeah, don't let me try to make biscuits. That's an ongoing tale. Apparently, I'm not able to be taught how to make biscuits. Amen? The point is, though, is when you look back, we find out that these programs have had some level of success, but it was limited. I mean, here's the results of a couple surveys were really close, so I picked the statistics, if you will, the numbers that seem to reflect a good average across about the last 10 or 15 years. And the question was asked, how do people come into a relationship with Christ and the church? 4 to 6% walk-ins. 6 to 8% pastor. 2 to 4% church programs. Well, we need to invest more in church programs, don't we? 1 to 2% visitation. 3 to 6% Sunday school. I look back 20 years ago, that was a greater number. Sunday school was the way that most people came in. How about this one? And this is one that's been used for 20, 30, 40 years. Billy Graham said that if he could do it over, he'd do it different. Because evangelical crusades and television programs, are you ready for this? The accounted level of success, write this, 0.0001%. Now that was a statistic that came from Billy Graham's website. And you can understand why he might do things different. He'd have 20, 30, 40,000 in a crusade. And they all might make it, watch this, they might have a decision for Jesus. But that was it. They just made a decision and they didn't go any farther. But are you ready for this one? 70 to 90% of ministry success, of church growth, friends and families. And I get that. Let's take an informal survey right here, right now today, and see if this is really true. If it is, then we should rethink how we witness and minister to our local community. Our local community is wherever we live, whatever neighborhood you're in. Whether you're in New Troy, whether you're in Michigan City, whether you're in LaPorte, whether you're in Trail Creek, whether you're in New Buffalo Township or City, whether you're in Grand Beach, wherever you are, that's your community. And then there are places that we travel. And any place that you travel is also part of your community. When you're there, you're part of that community. My point is, how much success are we having in those communities? See, I've been dealing with some things myself, because before I went back to work full time, I was ministering in my own neighborhood. And unfortunately, I've got to a place in my life where I'm okay, I know who they are, but I don't know their names. That's not good. They don't mind, but I'm only one person. My point is that that's a neighborhood, that's a place that I live, and that's a place that I should be visiting more often. Now, given the significance of the circumstances that everyone has been dealt with, maybe you're not as mobile as possible, but you know what? Open your door, invite some folks over. I said one thing before, inviting people to church is not the best form of evangelism. The best form of evangelism, if you want to witness to them, is get them to sit at a table and share a biscuit and a cup of coffee or share some time with them while you're sharing Jesus. But you might be wondering what needs to happen. I mean, think about this. How in the world do people come into a relationship with Christ and the church? If we were to take a brief survey here today, you'd have to go back quite a ways. But how did you come to a saving knowledge of Jesus? Where did it come from? Was it a family member? Was it a friend? And a few of us, that you might actually say that, you know, if it was a pastor came knock at my door, but wait a minute, I can promise you this, that most likely there was somebody who was not a pastor, who was not an evangelist, they were just a person who walked in faith, a person who met Jesus, that you knew first, and then their pastor came to you, but it's because of the relationship you had with them that you accepted a visitation from that pastor or that Sunday school teacher. Are you hearing me this morning? What has to come down to this is you've got to come to a place in your life where you say, no, this is an important part of my life. And the question is, well, what's important? Jesus? Being a Christian? It's important. And you've got to have an attitude for it, amen? And that brings us to these things here. The intent, the essential attitudes of witnessing. You've got to have an attitude. I want a show of hands of anybody here, and if anybody sees this message, you can send us a comment or whatever, email me, text me, whatever. I want a show of hands of anybody who came to Jesus because there was someone that says, you're going to go to hell if you don't change your ways. You're going to go to hell if you don't give up all that and come to Jesus. Any takers? How many came to Jesus for that? Didn't work, did it? Didn't work. Can't frighten them. You can't frighten somebody into heaven. And you can't frighten them out of hell. Oh, the love of Jesus. Oh, the love of Jesus. Oh, the love of Jesus.
It washes
white as snow. I'm so thankful for the blood of Jesus. Thankful for the blood of Jesus. I'm thankful for the blood of Jesus. It washes white as snow. And then next part. There is power in the blood of Jesus. Power in the blood of Jesus. Power
in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
Now, thank you for preaching that. Can I tell you that that kind of preaching, that kind of singing, is going to get more people's attention? And here's the thing. When the Holy Spirit is working on someone's heart, you need to be at the same place, at the same level the Holy Spirit is. The Holy Spirit, I don't see any account anywhere where it says the Holy Spirit scared somebody out of sin. I don't know about you, but just even considering how Jesus suffered and died on a cross was scary enough for me.
Amen.
But that's not about fear. You see, the problem with using fear tactics is this, and that is that fear is the anti-faith. Did you hear that? Fear is the anti-faith. In the scripture, we are told not to fear. But quite often we use that as a weapon, or we use that as a tool. And it's true that there are certain events that were scary, certain events that were significant in our lives enough to make us, to get our attention. There are certain things that we've done, and you're going to say, boy, if it had not been for Jesus. Wait a second. Just to be clear, Jesus was always there. Just like the Holy Spirit. But if you only came because you're afraid of hell, if you only came because you're afraid of judgment, wait a minute, that's the anti-faith. It's not faith at all. So we have to have the right attitudes in order for us to be able to witness to people. We must be convinced, here it is, we must be convinced, read it on the board, that being a Christian is the greatest thing in the world, not just another option. Sometimes we get all caught up. And I'm going to declare something to you. I'm probably going to get in trouble for this. Well, it doesn't matter. It does matter, but not so much whether you're Baptist, Methodist, Church of God, Church of God of Prophecy. Those things don't matter as much as just being a Christian. Being a Christian is the greatest thing on the face of the planet. It's not just another option. It's not just, well, I'm part of the Christian clan, the Christian group, the Christian club. No, it's not about that. You know, if we have any other attitude, then we're wasting our time and we're wasting the time of others. We wonder why our children aren't serving the Lord. And I mean, I have to deal with this some myself, but in one sense, I'm not doing too bad, but maybe they're not where I want them to be. But here's what I believe. They will come to the knowledge, and they will begin to serve. Amen?
Amen.
And if you live a life that's contrary to Christian living, and you're wondering why your children don't believe in God, why your children won't follow the Word of God, why your children won't come and worship, why your children, what? Look at the life. Look at what you're reflecting to them. I can live any old way that I want to. See, that's what you get to be as a Christian. And then the questions go, well, I can live any way I want to, too. I don't have to be a Christian. I can live my life without Christ. And did you know people can live their lives without Christ? But my goodness, can you believe that they're not going to live a life in the hereafter with Him? Can you believe that what's going to happen unless we come to a place in our walk with Jesus, we get the attitude that there's nothing more important? Well, there's nothing wrong with me carousing around with the group and running with the gang, long as I get to church on Sunday once in a while. Wait a second. You've got to come to a place in your life where I've got to get there. There's just something in me. There's something that has got this deep desire in me. I've got to get there, and I've got to share with others the love of Jesus. Turn to Ephesians chapter 2. Let me jump there real quick if I can. We need to understand something. Hey, if Phil was here, he'd quote it. You need to understand who you are and where you stand. And we need to understand where we are. Where we are now, where we were, where we are now, and where we're going in the future. And we got to start living our life now as if we're headed to someplace in the future. Listen to this. Ephesians chapter 2 says, "And you he made alive who were dead in trespasses and sin, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience." Among whom also we once conducted ourselves in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, just as the others. But God, say that with me big and loud. But God, I love this part. You need to wrap your mind around this and just get a hold of both hands. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together in Christ. By grace you've been saved. Hallelujah. By grace you've been saved and raised us up together and made us sit in the heavenly places in Jesus Christ, that in the ages that are to come, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. You didn't just choose to come to Christ. You just agreed.
Amen.
That he's already here.
Yes.
He is here. Hallelujah. He is here. Amen. He is here. Holy, holy, I will bless his name again. I want to bless his name because he's blessed mine. This all is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. This is not going to be anything new for you. There's a road that's already been paved for you. There's a path that we should walk. I know the path is narrow. I know the road is rough. But I'm here to tell you that if you would just walk within the hand of Jesus, he'll get you home safe. And not only that, but he'll create opportunities for you to help bring other people into the same knowledge of Christ. Amen? We were dead, but now we're alive with Christ. We will sit in heavenly places. We will enjoy those exceeding great riches of his grace, not only now, but in the ages that are to come. Amen? But we've got to understand that there has never been, nor is there now, anything wrong with the field known as the harvest field. If we go to Matthew chapter 9, I'm going to flip there real quick. Matthew chapter 9. I'm going to get through this somewhere. Okay. Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 9. Just let me share just a few verses of this particular chapter. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered like sheep, having no shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is truly plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." There are a lot of people in the world today who believe upon Jesus, and they believe they're saved because they were told and they bought, "If I believe, I receive, and I'm saved. There's nothing else required of me." Can I tell you that's part of the truth? These are people that don't attend any church anywhere. They don't identify with any particular group except, "Well, we're Christians." And I'm not going to get into a long dissertation this morning of how to argue with the fact that someone who's out there, just out there in the free universe alone, and doesn't have a place of gathering, doesn't gather regularly, that they're not Christians. They're not Christ-like. How many of you know that Jesus was in the synagogue quite regularly?
Yes.
Got got himself in trouble a few times, but then he got crucified because they didn't want to hear the truth. How many of you this morning want the truth?
Amen.
But what I'm here to tell you right now is there's nothing wrong with the harvest field. Even today, if you look out there, there are a lot of people out there. They're like sheep who have no shepherd. There's no one that's counseling with them. There's no pastor in their life. There's no one equipping them for ministry. They're not doing any ministry for Jesus. If anything, they're usurping and they're undermining the work of God in the church. Amen? See, there are those who will say that it is just so difficult to get folks to be saved today. But I seem to remember in the Old Testament there was a story about Abraham and Sarah. And here's the deal. There was a question asked when the angel was telling them they're going to have a baby. And Sarah's an old woman. Apparently she figured, hey, I'm an old woman, my womb's dried up. How can I be given birth to a child? As a matter of fact, if I remember correctly, the Bible says she laughed at the thought. Yeah, really? Well, right, I'm going to have a baby. And of course, she believed, in part she believed God. That's how she gets in trouble, because now she's going to try to help God out. I'm not going to go into that story, but it'll be another time. But here's the deal. When she laughed, there was a question asked, is anything too hard for God? Let me ask you this, and everybody, if you can, at one time, give me the answer. I'm sure you're going to give me the same one. Is anything too hard for God?
No.
Is there really anything too hard for the Lord? Is anything too hard that he can't do? And here's the deal. In the scripture, she was told at the appointed time, the baby was going to come. See, we've got to come to a place where we realize that there's nothing too hard for God. But the trouble has always been with the reapers. In Luke chapter 10, verse 2, he said that the harvest truly is great, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. In John, verse 4, 35, it says, do you not say there are still 4 months, and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white, the harvest. You want to be leading somebody to Jesus, you don't have to look far. We must believe also that people are hungry. Well, what are they hungry for? There's a song that we sing, and we talk about, we've seen people that they're looking for answers to the questions that we've all been asking. And did you know it's the same answer? There are these people, they're really hungry for the gospel. They just don't know what it's about. They just don't know that it's the gospel for which they belong looking for. 2 Colossians 4, verse 3 and 4 says, meanwhile, praying also for us that God would open a door, open us a door for the word to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I'm also in chains, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak, that I know how to speak. Maybe you should pray this for yourself. Lord, I'm gonna share something with, my aunts, my cousins, my friends, my neighbors, my enemies. I'm going to talk about Jesus. But Lord, I'm asking for a door of opportunity. But not only that, I want to be able to make sure I'm sharing the words right. Yes. You say, well, Pastor, I don't know that they really want this sort of thing. First off, let me tell you what every one of us long for. How many in here desire success in your life? Don't you long for some level of success? And what if I told you right now that if we just take just 30 seconds and just think of one area of your life where you've been successful? No, wait, here's the problem. Maybe you've had many failures. Boy, did I. And if I thought about those failures, I'd be like most of the rest of the world. But no, there's been some level of success in my life. And it's because of God. It's not because of illness. It's not because of anything that I've done or could do that he hasn't enabled me to do it. People long for the success. Have you had any success in your walk with the Lord? Have you been saved from certain habits or maybe certain attitudes, maybe some of us need to be saved from ourselves, and you can say, yep, that was me, I got saved from me. People long for success. You say, well, okay, well, how do I tell them about that? This book. Joshua chapter 1, verse 8 says, the book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, right? But you shall meditate on it day and night, that you might observe to do all that's recorded, written in it. For there you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. You know, when I was entering into ministry, I really, in the early days of study and going to the interviews and all that with the leaders in the Church of God in Michigan, there was a time I thought, you know, I could just kind of step back on this. But there was something in me that said, no, you can't. But Lord, I'm afraid. And the Lord says, did I not command you not to be afraid, need to be dismayed? But if you want to have success in your life, some of you just in the last decade or so, or maybe less, have come to realize that unless you have the Word of God, you're not going to be successful in the things that matter the most. And listen, you really got to come to a place where you love the Word of God and the author that wrote it. Who wrote the Word of God? Well, you know, there were 40 authors. Hold on. Who inspired them to write? The Word of God is that. It's the Word of God. If you want the Word of God, if you love the Word of God, let me tell you what you'll do. You will share with the world that which you love. You will share with the world that which excites you the most. And the little Sunday school stories can only take you so far in life. But you need to come to a place where you realize that the only way to have success in life is to know the Word of God and do the Word of God. Because if you know the Word, do the Word, you're in the will of God. Hello! No one said it's going to be easy, by the way. Neither was it always going to be just smooth sailing. But people long for success, and people long for peace. Life is very short. And there's no time for fussing and fighting, my friends. I know that was not necessarily gospel, but it's the truth, isn't it? And it's not just that we can just get along. No. But we all long for peace. Isaiah 26:3 says, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts you, talking about God. Do you or do you not trust God today? Remember, he is powerful. Amen. He's almighty. And people long for fulfillment. They have desires they long to have met. John chapter 10, verse 10. But the thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly, that they might have their life's longings fulfilled. And how about the desire for happiness? Anybody? Show of hands, who would like to be happy? Can't we just all be happy? Be happy. Don't worry. Psalm 146, verse 5 says this, happy is he who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God. In his presence is fullness of joy. At his right hand is pleasures, happiness forevermore. To be happy in Jesus, I must trust and obey. And we've got to understand that God, ready for this? God is the ultimate evangelist, and we are merely his instruments. You can be a preacher, a teacher, or whatever, but when it comes right down to it, the Holy Ghost himself is the evangelist. Did you hear that? You might have been empowered. You might have been anointed. You might actually have some of these abilities. And it might be an office that you serve in, the office of the evangelist. And did you know almost every one of us have a little bit of that in us? Consider your calling. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26, it says this. For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things. Okay, God has chosen the foolish things. I think I just spoke about the majority of the people in our churches today. I'm going to let that sink in for a minute. Did he just say I was foolish? I'm with you. Amen? But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame those things that are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen, and the things which are not, to bring to nothing that the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him you are in Jesus Christ, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that, as it was written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord. If you got anything to say glory about, let it be something that you glory in the Lord. Amen? You know, Paul understood this. Paul understood this when he said, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. If you've ever led anybody to Christ, quit taking credit for it, like you're trying to notch your Bible. Quit taking credit for it, like you're making somebody out to be, well, this is a project, this is someone I was working on. Let me tell you, if you worked on it, expect it to fall apart. But if God was the one that did it, lest the Lord builds the house, lest the Lord builds up that person, listen, it's been done in vain. Did you hear me this morning? We've got to yield to God in order to be used by God. Listen, do not present your members, this is Romans chapter 6, verse 13. Do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Oh, let me move on. I'm going to move on. In other words, I'm saying you need to be a real witness to Jesus. You've got to be genuine. Have you ever felt that your efforts for witness has failed?
Amen.
And you might say, why have we failed in our ministry to witness? Let me tell you one of the reasons. And I'm thanking God for this right now, because almost every time I've had an opportunity, it wasn't as if I planned it. It's as if I was thrust into it, but I found I was moving in the Spirit. Thank God for the Spirit. Here's the question for you. Have you lost your spontaneity? Remember the four keys of hearing God's voice? Vision. Wait, stillness, vision. Right? You want to see what God's saying. You want to know how many of you want to see what he's trying to tell you. Show them where to go. Then spontaneity, flowing in the Spirit. Amen? So here, have we lost our spontaneity? Have we lost the ability to flow in the Spirit? Peter tells us to be ready always to give an answer for every man that asks the reason for the hope that's in you. Listen, if you don't want to go to jail, you need to come to Jesus. Do you know that doesn't work? It doesn't work. They may have to go to jail before they come to Jesus. I don't know. I've seen that happen. Listen, some of you might remember, it's been a while ago, and a lot of you might remember this, but there was a man who showed up here one Christmas. And he was here, we were having a late night service, and he was here, and I sat and talked with him, and he confessed an awful lot of stuff. And I told him, I said, listen, all I can tell you is this. Everything you told me, if what you're telling me is true and accurate, you need to go back to wherever you came from. You need to confess. 2 years later, on a Christmas, the same man comes. And he said, you know what? I did what you told me to do. He says, I just got out of jail last week. But he's not the same man. I don't have time to share the whole story. He was estranged from his father. His dad didn't want anything to do with him. It took three Church of God ministers to get him back where he lived. I drove him to Muskegon, a pastor in Muskegon, drove him up to Traverse City. Another pastor drove him up someplace else. I can't even pronounce the name of the town. And what I heard was I received a phone call from a man I didn't even know was responding, asking who I was and how it is I talked his son into turning himself in. I just said, do it. But are you hearing what I'm telling you today? We've got to be spontaneous. If we were on to be honest, we would have to admit that we're not always ready to witness to the lost, are we? And just to be clear, you're not going to witness to the lost if you are acting like someone who's lost. You're still living like someone who might not be saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost. You're doing everything that the rest of the world does. Does that mean I can't go to parties? I didn't say that. But you'll conduct yourself different. Have we lost our creativity? There are a lot of other scriptures to witness besides Romans Road. I mean, it's a good thing to remember these things to be able to quote the Romans Road. If we only know one method of communicating the gospel, what will happen when we speak to someone the second or third time and we don't have anything else to tell them? I don't have time to give you a whole lot of things. Maybe tonight we'll give you some more assignments. But, you know, there's some of us, have you ever heard of the King's Road? I bet most of us here have never heard of it. I only ever heard of it once. The King's Road, this is King David's Road. Psalm 14 and 3, Psalm 37, 38, Psalm 103, 10 and 11. And tonight we're going to go over those things. But it's just another road. It's another path to take. But it's not like it's all roads lead to heaven. That's not what I'm talking about. It's another way to communicate the gospel. Though I was lost, now I've been found. I was blind, now I can see. Hallelujah. Amen. And see, a genuine witness comes out of something else that we all need to have. We need to have a love for Christ and a love for others. We'll talk about that more tonight as well. We need to have a love for Christ and others. I mean, Jesus taught this familiar parable of how to genuinely witness to the lost. If we go to Luke chapter 10, I'm going to jump there real quick. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Here we go. Let me jump there real quick. Luke chapter 10. My precious just got here. Amen. Luke chapter 10, verse 33. Let me know when you get there. But I'm just going to take, I'm going to read it to you anyway. Here we go. Luke chapter 10, verse 33. But a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. So he went to him and bandaged his wounds, poured on the oil and the wine, and set on him his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. And on the next day, when he departed, he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said to him, take care of him, and whatever more is spent, when I come again, I will repay you. In other words, I don't know this person, he's a stranger, but they need help. I had compassion on him. In the scripture, you'll be hearing me preach this over and over again. On some, have compassion, on others, win them with fear, pulling them from the fire. See, a genuine witness comes out of true love for Christ and for your fellow man. Compassion. When we have compassion towards others, we treat them as God treated us.
Amen.
Amen. I mean, look what happened. Oh, contact. Contact with that person. He went to him. He didn't text him, didn't call him, didn't send him a postcard. No, he went to him. The thieves, the world had left him for dead. The religionists, those priests, and people read the rest of the story, what they do? They pass by. None of their business. Some of you, that's how you act. But this man made contact with the one who was hurting. And then care for him. It isn't enough that we have compassion and make contact. We also must minister to them personally. Amen? And then there's a cost. It's going to cost something. A ministry that costs nothing seldom ever accomplishes anything. I guess I'm going to say this. Love your neighbors as yourselves. You hear what I said? I don't have time to get into it today, but who's your neighbor? What's more important is, rather than determining who your neighbor is, learn how to be a good neighbor yourself. Hey, listen, the insurance company says, as like a good neighbor, that insurance company is fair. I think we should be able to do better than some insurance company, because we actually have a better plan, amen? Better benefits will come. But even then, someone's going to have to pay a cost. Shall be witnesses to me. Have we failed? Have we failed in our witness? Have we been living a life that witnesses to those about us? Make no mistake, no one will be saved simply by watching our lives, simply by just by seeing us. Somewhere along the way, we've got to come to a place where we can give them the gospel message, where we speak to them, where we perhaps lay hands on them, but how we live our lives before them will determine how responsive they will be. You continue to live like the world, you can say all that you want, but you're not going to get anywhere with them. It's about people, places, and things. The things that we do, the things that we say. Do we have compassion? Really? Do you have compassion for the lost? Or are you one of those kind of people that think, well, you know, I'm on the way to heaven. Sorry for their bad luck. And I tell you, you're going to be different. You're going to be sorry and disappointed on that great, terrible day. Are we willing to contact others? Are we willing to truly reach out? Are we willing to care for them by ministering to their needs? Are we willing to pay what it costs to minister to them? These are questions that we must ask. And we must come to grips with. If we desire to become fishers of men. Can we just let God have his way right now? Together, everyone. Lord, don't let us, we pray. Help us go through our lives as your followers, not fishing for men, not doing what you have clearly called us to do. Commission us, set us apart to do. Make us fishers of men, we pray. Set our hearts on fire to share Christ with all whom we know. We pray the fruit of our lives will be many other people coming into a right relationship with Christ and his church. When the song ministers to you, say like a Forrest Gump, that's all I got to say about that. Yeah. But then even though, oh no, he's got more to say. And that's why we'll gather here again this evening to review what God has spoken to you today. My hope is that you will be inspired and based upon the song, set on fire. Inside on fire of the Holy Spirit, encouraged, empowered, and enabled by the Word of God. Would you lift your hands to heaven and say, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we ask God that everyone that's here today would be blessed. and become a blessing to all that they know. Lord, as we dismiss from this fellowship here in the sanctuary, we go to the fellowship hall, where we gather in community to break bread together. We give you thanks, Lord, for the food that we're about to receive, and as we always do, we say, Lord, may it be nourishment to our bodies. We also pray, Lord, that you find yourself welcome and have a seat at one of the tables, at any table, and that God, that you are welcome here, even as we make each and every other person here welcome. We thank you, Lord, for this day, and we bless you and each other in Jesus' name. And the church agreed, said, amen, amen. God bless you.
Before we all leave, I got something to say.
Yeah. Well,
we've been celebrating this week, but we also got another thing to celebrate. Our pastor's birthday.
This is my birthday.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
You got something
for us to say, honey. I just wish you a happy birthday from all of us here at church.
Where's she going? No, no, it's autumn. I
feel like you got on this, you know.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday,
dear Daddy.
Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday. Come here, Carly.
So we'll see you over there.
And you'll be first in line, Pastor, so nobody can get in line till you get over.